Here we are, myself, Barry Blanchard, sitting down to interview Simone Moro here after his fabulous presentation last night.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And we're at the Banff Center. And I'll start kind of at the beginning. How did you start climbing?
I started when I was a kid. Now I'm 39, so it means it's quite a long time ago. And I started not immediately in rock climbing. I spent a lot of vacation, student vacation with my parents and me with my brothers. I go in Dolomites, and we did many walk, trail, camping. And then we start to do the Via Ferrata. And this had been the first approach to the vertical side of the mountain. And one day when I was 13, I requested my father, look, Dad, I would like to become a real climber. And he told me, okay, Simone, I will teach you. He was a normal climber. And I felt immediately in love with, with such kind of activities. And so my beginning, if I have to identify in one particular age, it had been in 13, when I was 13. And my career is also quite strange because now we everybody talk about Simone Moro as a high altitude climber. That is true. But my beginning was as a rock climber and also as a competitor because I had been from 1985, so when I was 17, to 1990. So for 5 years, I did only competition, rock climbing competition. But also during these 5 years of competition, I used to spend time also in the mountain because I liked the nature and so on. I decided to stop with the competition, continue to rock climb. I enjoy also now, but start with, to return to the mountain. No? And I start with like, my expedition. So my first expedition had been 1992. Until now, from 92 till 2006, I already did 36 expeditions.
So when you're spending time in the mountains in Italy, are you doing any alpine climbing in the Alps?
Yes, I like to make alpine climb. I climb on Mont Blanc, Monte Bianco, Cervino, Matterhorn, Monte Rosa, and also in Dolomites. We are in the middle of the Dolomites, so it's half an hour car. That's why I try to have one 360 degrees view about the climbing world. It means I don't like only high altitude or only ice or only rock climb. I try to combine sharing my time, to combine all the specialities. So it gives me also the possibility to be ready to climb any kind of phase and to be able to survive in any kind of situation.
All right, what was the what was your first expedition in 92?
In 92, and was one good experience because it was unsuccessful expedition for me. I had no experience in high altitude. And I didn't pay attention to the acclimatization process. And when I arrived to the base camp, after a few days, really, I was already in camp 3, 7-4. And I said to my colleague, why everybody said to be slow? It's very simple. Okay, tomorrow we go to South Coast. And the day after, I was in silver edema. So I risked also my life. So I learned very much also from this expedition, from this experience.
Right.
So the first expedition was on the highest mountain of the world with the highest lesson that I can get from the mountain. It means that it's better to respect always the experience of the other guys and also
the mountain.
The mountain.
The mountain. So what happened when you got the cerebral edema? Where were you and how'd you get down?
I was just in time to realize that I get the cerebral edema because, for example, I had the gloves and the socks, and they put the socks on my hand, and the gloves I tried to put on my feet. And so the friends that was around me, they understand, oh, something. So Simone, it's better to go down. And in few moments, I had some flash where I realized what I was doing. Looked like when you are drunk. And with the help of my friends, I started to come down. The first 2 hours, the help of my friend was really important. Then I returned to be cautious, going down, so I taking more oxygen on the way down. And then I walked to the base camp. I promised at that time to the doctor to remain in base camp. I break a little bit the promise because I went many times till come three, not over, to help all the team.
Yeah.
And so I have also the big luck to know what it means to have one cerebral edema, but to avoid to have any kind of damages.
Okay. So what happened after 92 then? You obviously went back
to
Himalaya.
I went back and I said, look, now Simone, you did a mistake, so it's your fault. It's natural that you get this high altitude sickness because everybody can have the same sickness if they run as you did so fast to the mountain. But I also understood that it could be my new way of the evolution of the kind of alpinism I did before. That's why in 93 I went to Makalu and on Aconcagua, but in winter. And we stopped 400, 500 meters below the summit. After all the steepest part, there's a big plateau, and on the Messner variant to arrive to the summit, we set the last camp, and we have 5 days storm and snowfall. So we was there, we was not able to do nothing. We finished completely our gas, our food, and after the fifth day, the weather was still bad, but we realized, okay, we can't stay here more because we will die. We can't climb up because it's a slope, so every moment there was avalanche come down. The only solution is try to go down. But to climb in alpine style, it means you don't have any fixed point, any fixed slope. And I don't know how we did hundreds of
rappels.
Yeah. And at the end, after 1.5 day, we was at the base of the south face. We went back to the villages, taking rest. Then we returned, and that time we climbed from the other side, always in winter, in 13 hours. Oh. So we went to the summit and back. Oh. And it had been a good experience because, okay, Aconcagua, every climber said, okay, Aconcagua is high, but it's simple, it's high, it's simple. And sometimes it's enough to wait 2-3 months. And so wait that the season change and come in the winter, and those Aconcagua, I can guarantee, become a very difficult mountain. Even I believe there doesn't exist easy mountain anywhere.
Yeah.
Well, could be easy in case of good condition, weather condition, if everything is going well, could appear easy, one mountain. But also Aconcagua in that time was very difficult to get it. And then we went to Makalu, and the expedition led by Josef Rakonsai, is the only man who climbed K2 from both sides. At that time, but also today, is the only one. And we follow the Kukuchka route, and we stop at 8,200 due to the strong wind on the ridge, because the Kukuchka route went directly on the west face and then stay on the ridge. So if you have strong wind, you are not repaired, and you have to resist if you are able to do it. And that time was too strong wind, so we came back till Makalula. All the other guys went back and they slept there, and they make another attempt the day after. I was watching one rocky summit, and I was thinking, okay, this is the summit. So I put all my power to get there. And when I arrived there, I saw that the summit was, again, 140 meters is not so much, but it means 1.5 hour to go and 1.5 hour to bed.
Yeah.
And I have no power. The real reason, I was exhausted.
Right.
Also for the attempt of days before. So I went back, and so in 94 was, okay, good, the winter climb of Shishapangma, of Aconcagua, and a good attempt on Kukuchka route. And then in 94 I was in Lhotse. I summited with a speed ascent, 17 hours, so it was quite fast. I learned how to acclimatize, I learned many things also when I failed. So in 94 I climbed Lhotse. In 95 I was in Kanchenjunga. In 96 I went to Patagonia. And I climbed the Fitzroy along the Super Canaleta. Also that time in 24 hours, base camp, summit, base camp. And in 96 I also summited, I was in Patagonia, then in Daulagiri, but we failed in Daulagiri. Then I went to Shishapangma, and we summited Shishapangma. Also in that time, in 29 hours, we went up to the summit and back. And when I said I was a speed ascent. It was not the real goal of the expedition, because when I did some speed ascent, it's only because I feel ready. Maybe the weather is not so good and give me only a window of 1-2 days. So I try to keep this small window of good weather to be as fast as I can.
Yeah.
And that's why many times I realize speed ascent. It's not because I think that the speed ascent are the best way to approach to the mountain. Could be the only way when the bad weather can give other kind of possibility. If you want to climb in a classic style, taking 1 week, 5 days, and the weather don't give you more than 24 hours, 48 hours of good weather, could be interesting to be ready to make a rush.
Yeah.
And in 96 on Shishapangma, I met Anatoly Bukhreyev. Oh,
okay.
That was the key moment of my career. Mm-hmm. Because he climbed 1 day before me, Shishapangma. Mm-hmm. Or we climbed together till camp 2, and the day after was really stormy weather, and Bukhreyev came to my tent and said, Simone, okay, we start for the summit. I said, look, Buka, you see the weather? Well, it's impossible. No, possible, it's possible. I said, oh, it's too dangerous, too cold. So I remained there, and Bukhreyev started and went alone to the summit. Mm-hmm. And I was impressed, and I said, look, this guy has something special. So the day after, me and my friend had been motivated from him. Mm-hmm. We went to the summit. And after the expedition, we became friends.
Mountain couple.
Yeah. Mountain couple.
So where did you get to climb with Anatoly?
So I had the experience in Shishapangma. Then the year after, in 97, we climbed again for the second time for both Lhotse, mm-hmm. because our real project was to attempt the first traverse Lhotse and Everest. Right, it means climb Lhotse, going down South Col, climb Everest, and go down in Tibet.
Yeah.
So we apply for the three permits, Lhotse and Everest from Nepal side and Everest from Tibetan side, so to be allowed to do the traverse. But we arrive on the summit of Lhotse with bad weather, but also had been strange with bad physical condition of Anatoly. Because 20 days before our attempt on Lhotse, he already was on the summit of Everest with one Indonesian expedition. Right. He was guiding one expedition.
Yeah.
And when he went after the summit with Indonesian, he went back to the base camp and then went back by helicopter to Kathmandu. Mm-hmm. And he took one virus, food virus.
Okay. Yeah.
He and also his friend, Vladimir Bashkirov, who also was with Anatoly, the guide of the Indonesian team.
Okay.
So and when he went back to the base camp, he took 2 days rest and then we start for the summit. And we summited, but I saw that he was not fast and strong as usual. Mm-hmm. And he told me, I remember forever the words of Anatoly when we were on the summit of Lhotse. He told me, Simone, where we are, what we are doing. And also Vladimir Bashkirov, who came with us on summit of Lhotse, he was included in another team, in a Russian team. Vladimir dead on the way down. He was exhausted. Because also Anatoly on the summit of Lhotse said, what we are doing, where we are. There was stormy weather. It was not possible to see clearly the ridge that we have to climb down towards South Col in case we want to continue to make the travel. So to combine the two problems, bad visibility, bad weather, and bad condition of Anatoly, we decided immediately, okay, it's already one success. We are here on the summit of the four highest peaks in the world. For the second time for both, it's better go down. Vladimir arrived 1 hour later on the summit. We met him when we was going down, and they saw Vladimir, he was in bad condition, and also told him, Vladimir, come down. And he told me, no, Simone, don't worry. And this had been the last time that I met him, because after he reached the summit, and on the way back, he collapsed.
Right.
And also, during the expedition on Lhotse of 97, we decided also to make one winter attempt of 1,800 meter peak. Mm-hmm. Okay, the winter climb of the highest peak of the world is really the hardest way to approach to the alpinism or such kind of alpinism. Mm-hmm. And we decide for Annapurna, because Annapurna was one of the 8,000 missing to Anatoly.
Right.
Annapurna was recognized as one of the most difficult 8,000-meter peak, even it is not one of the highest. And we decide to go along the south face, mm-hmm. that is also probably one of the most difficult face to mm-hmm. climb. And, okay, we also decide another extra thing, to avoid to have any kind of satellite communication at the base camp. Because mm-hmm. he said, okay, the communication is very important, but could kill the adventure.
Right.
It means all the person know exactly where you are in every moment. There is no pathos, no?
Yeah.
And so in that expedition, we said, okay, we go only me and you. Probably we take one cameraman, mm-hmm. no Sherpa, no oxygen, and no communication, as the old style of half century ago.
Right.
We go for 1 month, 1.5 months, nobody will know where we are, what we are doing. And when we come back, we will explain what was going on. We will show the film and so on. And it was the decision, I can say, maybe a good decision in the wrong moment. Mm-hmm. Because it had been that expedition on Annapurna, the only expedition where the communication was extremely necessary, also mm-hmm. because it's happened one tragedy.
Yeah, yeah.
And so after the tragedy, I have no way to contact them.
You made reference last night to crack hours writing about Anatoly,
yeah,
and you obviously have quite a different opinion of the man.
Yeah, first of all, I have to say, what I said yesterday to the audience, mm-hmm. that I disagree with Krakauer and why.
Yeah.
If I can try to take out from one moment this friendship and analyzing only as a mountain guide. So me and you, we are both, we are GM mountain guide. We analyze two expeditions. There are guide and clients. Guide and clients. Both went to the summit and they come back. Okay? The first things that they teach us is you have to save your clients. Mm-hmm. In the expedition of Anatoly, no one client's dead.
Yeah.
Dead one guide. In the other expedition, dead guide and clients.
Yeah.
And Anatoly Bukreyev, that was in this expedition, get rescue and save clients of this expedition.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay? Mm-hmm. So mathematically, it's obvious to say that this expedition has a very small damage, dead the leader, the guide,
yeah. mm-hmm.
but no one clients. And here could be much more the damage if Anatoly was not so strong to rescue. So I don't understand why John mm-hmm. pretend to teach to Anatoly Bukreyev what he has to do in this expedition. He has only to thank God that Anatoly was there. So this is the first, how to say, cold approach that I can have analyzing the things. One the guide dead, one the guide dead, guide and clients dead.
Mm-hmm.
And my friends rescue also person who don't know. And second of all, this is, I am the only person in life who can say what's happened on Annapurna mm-hmm. with Anatoly. Well, in the last version of the book of John Krakauer, the new edition, because he became millionaires.
Yeah, he's been very successful
with
it.
The person who did, one guy who make rescue and one guy who make money.
Right.
This also I don't love so much.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, I can accept that the world is working like this. But John wrote in his postscript, he wrote also, now Anatoly is dead, I'm sorry that he's dead, blah, 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 blah. He was in expedition with Simone Moro, a strong climber of Italy. They climbed Lhotse, and he described what's going on Lhotse. And then he described what's happened on Annapurna. I repeat, I am the only person in life who can say what's happened. Mm-hmm. John never called me.
Right, right.
Not one email.
Huh.
So if he used the same style to get the news,
Right.
And
right.
This is the style he get and he used to get the information from the tragedy. How I can believe in that book?
Hmm.
The demonstration that he probably is not so accurate is this.
Yeah.
In fact, there is many bullshit written.
Yeah.
He told that we was guiding a Russian expedition on Lhotse. We was going without oxygen and one person dead, Vladimir Bashkirov.
Yeah.
So it means that Anatoly didn't learn the lesson of the previous expedition of 96. He continued to go guiding without oxygen. Yeah. We were sharing the permit. Yeah. And the Russian expedition was the strongest team in Russia. They was attempting the traverse between Lhotse and Lhotse Shah. Huh. We was only sharing the permit. We was not guiding anybody.
So in your book.
So he make mistake. he is a wonderful writer.
He
wrote a wonderful book. The only thing is not a true book. He probably has to say this is a romance.
Yeah.
And so, everything was without any kind of discussion.
Yeah. But in your book, you must, I'm assuming that in your book, you, you know, you lay
No, not because I didn't say anything about the 96 tragedy or nothing against Krakauer because I was not there. The only two person who can say what's happened had been John and Anatoly and the other member who wrote many books. I was not there. Anatoly told me many nice things that are not written in the book that give me confirmation that Anatoly was working well. But in my book, I wrote only about the tragedy of 97. The first pages, I explain who I am and how I met Anatoly. So I have to describe shortly my climbing career, but very shortly. Yes. And they said, and one day arrived the moment where I met Anatoly. And the book, real book, starts in this point. So I describe the expedition of 97, the last expedition of Anatoly. And I describe who he was. Mm-hmm. He was not, how to say, one angel. Eh? Yeah. He was not God. I'm not blind.
Yeah.
He was a normal person. It's only because I want that the people knows exactly who Anatoly was what's really happened. We weren't suicide ourselves, killing ourselves, climbing under one avalanche or under one serac, as some person said.
Yeah.
We was attempting a new route, tried to be as much protected as we could. But the tragedy is happening in any case. Okay, is one book speaking about our friendship and about, unfortunately, the last expedition of Bukhrev. Honestly, I consider him as one of my teacher.
Yeah.
And he called me always my little brother. So I feel as his student, no?
Yeah.
Now I miss him and I have to find my way. And I find, of course, my way. Now I'm 39, I have my experience, I have everything. But it's a pity that Anatoly is not in life, because in this moment he can represent also another way to approach to the high altitude, also to the professionist, to the mountain.
Right.
Because really he was Russian, he was living in Kazakhstan, but he was very, very open-minded and he learned many things, but he also was able to teach many things. Mm. And from him, for example, I learned to be, how to say, one animal in high altitude. And say one animal is not a bad thing. It means to be completely one part of the mountain.
Sure. Yeah.
And had been a wonderful things to learn.
Huh. You know, my own observations on it are, because he came from the Eastern Bloc, he just had a different approach to it. It meant something different to him. In my mind, it was an expression of, you know, valor for him, or his life, his spirit.
Yeah.
And for me, you know, I live in the mountains. I love the mountains. I feel like I'm part of the mountain, but I didn't have as much tolerance for risk.
Yeah, I'm agree with you.
Kind of recreation still.
I'm agree with you, but try to think for 1 second that you born in Russia under a communist system where you have to follow always orders as a military, in the school, in the family. Also in the army sport club where he was when he was alpinist, you have to follow one particular process. You can say, today I go and want to climb this route.
Niet.
Is forbidden. First, you have to follow the program, make examination. Yeah. You pass the first level. So when you are the first level, these are the routes you can climb. So I can understand that he born in such kind of education. Then the Soviet Union collapsed.
Yeah, yeah.
So also his climbing activities has no sponsor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because before was paid from the government. Mm-hmm. And he has to learn when he was already adult. Mm-hmm. How to.
Yeah.
And he came in America, the most free country where you have to be fast, the business, everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And probably he was shocked and he was not ready also for the personal relation. So
He
has such kind of barrier because this was really what he told me. He said, look, you are learning from me to be an animal in the mountain, but I have to learn to be a man in the normal society.
Okay, I wanted to ask you who Tom Moores is.
Look, Tom Moores.
Story. Yeah.
Tom Moores is one English guy that I rescued in 2001. I was climbing Lhotse, attempting again the Lhotse Traverse, Lhotse Everest Traverse. Mm-hmm. It's my dream. And so in that day, I start from 6,000 meters directly to 8,000 meters on Lhotse face, carrying my tent, everything.
Yeah.
Me and Denis Urubku, my partner. We set the tent. We have to work 2 hours because it was icy face.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, we set the tent. And then we went inside the tent, tired, from 6,000 to 8,000, carrying everything. We were tired. We are not Rambo.
Yeah.
and after a few minutes, we heard someone screaming. Huh. And said, what's going on? We was not alone in that place. When we set the tent, there was already three tents from one Spanish team, one Polish team, and some Sherpa. We heard someone screaming, so I opened the zip of my tent. And I saw one guy coming up from 7-8, coming towards me. An accident. He was not speaking English very well.
Right.
So I have to wait till he arrived to me. And when he arrived, he told, look, my friend, one English boy, he was 19, fell down after he reached the summit of Lhotse.
He fell down
as a miracle. He stopped in one snow pad, mm-hmm. but not along the route, completely out on the west face.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to him, he told this guy, he was one Polish, Darek mm-hmm. Zaluski, the author of the film Ciao Martina and the mm-hmm. other film, The Winter Climb of Shishapangma. So after mm-hmm. we became friends, but I didn't knew him before. So he told me, I saw him fell, mm-hmm. slowly I went till him, mm-hmm. 2 hours walking to him. I gave my bottle of oxygen, and now I come here asking you or someone if you can do something. Mm-hmm. But it was nearly 5 o'clock in the evening, so last hour of light. I said, okay, immediately I prepare myself, and I started going down, traversing down the rocky barrier and climbing up mm-hmm. towards the direction. And I started alone because all the other guys, the Spanish team or so, they heard about that story. But I had been the only one who started. The other guys said, okay, it's impossible to do something.
Right, right.
Probably he's already dead.
Huh.
Now he's coming the night. How we can help him? Probably he's broken some legs. Anyway, I find him.
Uh-huh.
I was, again, without oxygen. So from 8,000, descending to 7-8. Traversing below the rocky bend, climbing up till 8,000, where finally I find him. Was very lucky because from the far distance it looks one like a stone.
Yeah.
Because he didn't move, nothing. Probably he was waiting for the dead.
Yeah.
And they told, okay, how are you? He didn't answer. And they told him, you know Anatoly Bukreyev? Yes, I am the partner of Anatoly Bukreyev. What he did in 96, now I will do for you, don't worry. Because he said to me, no, you can do nothing. Da, da, da.
No.
I said, no, don't worry. There is no problem. But inside of myself, I said, oh, my God, what I will do now? And I carry him.
No.
So I climb up towards the beginning of the Cold War.
Right.
So 8,200, 1,150.
Yeah.
Then I'm traversing above the rocky bends. And I went down to my tent.
Wow.
When I arrived 10 meters near my tent, 10, 15 meters, someone came to me, one with the camera,
right, yes, yes,
and
yes,
one
yes.
taking him.
Right.
He helped me for 10 meters, and then he put the Tom in my tent. This is your things.
Yes.
So I have to sleep without sleeping bag, make injections, make massage, take heparin, because he gets some frostbite, blood, and so on. And by walkie-talkie, I organized one rescue.
Huh.
This is the story. Tom now is alive. So now, of course, now we became friends. Of course, this rescue took all my power.
Yeah.
So I threw out the project. Yeah. And you know better than me, when you said, okay, I can't continue my climb because I am exhausted, it means to put in the rubbish $100,000.
Oh, wow.
Because permit of Everest from north, permit of Everest of south, lots and so on. So now Tamur is alive and had been one rescue. Many people saw this rescue, also Michael Brown, the famous cameraman, cameraman.
Yeah.
And I think he get also the film of the rescue, Till the Darkness, because after I continue in the darkness, the rescue till the night.
Right.
And that's why it became quite famous, this rescue, because so many people was watching from Camp 2 and Camp 3, what I did alone. And now Lhotse and Everest are still there.
Yeah.
I can start again for attempt the traverse. Yeah, I don't know how I get the power, honestly. Eh?
Yeah.
Because, if you help someone because you give your hands and he walk, it's one kind of effort.
I know how.
If you have to carry someone in such a kind of attitude, it's something that I was not expecting to be able to do.
It was your big brother. Anatoly was with you.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. I also think about that. Probably I learned very well what he was able to do. I did myself with another guy, with Tom Moore.
Great. Unfortunately, we're out of time.
Okay.
But thank you very much,
Thank
Simone.
You for you to have me here. For the interview.
Great. Yeah. I've got another list of questions, but we'll have to do another.
I talk too much.
we'll start with them next time.
Okay.
No, you did well. Thanks so much.
Thank you.